Hello and welcome to Inside the Women of Denver, where we talk to local leaders about their successes, failures, and lessons learned on the journey to success. I'm Crystal Covington, and I'm here with Arielle Lavav, a young, savvy entrepreneur who is building a name for herself in the cannabis industry. Her business, Affluent Leaders Agency, aka All Time High Events, helps businesses in the industry increase their visibility in the market and build a sustainable events-based marketing model. Arielle, I'm so excited to have you on the show.
Thank you. I am too. I'm excited to be here.
So I'm sure the first thing on everybody's mind is, how did you think this up? It is genius.
Oh, well, thank you. Well, I have a long history of working in hospitality. So I've worked at various hotels and management positions, bartending, serving. I've been on the event side as an employee. I've learned from that what puts a great event on and how to make a great event. And then I started actually deciding I wanted to become a part of the cannabis industry. And it was really deciding, how can I do that? What is my avenue going to be? I looked into different ways of doing product development or things like that and helping companies grow their name. And then it just opened up to me, like, well, why don't I use my skill set? And so I started All Time High Events. It is a DBA of Affluent Leaders Agency, mm-hmm. because it's kind of the break off of the main agency where we host events for different companies.
Okay.
So the idea is to really bring all these different events that everyone loves to go to and attend to, but to give them a better pizzazz than what everyone's already doing.
Yeah. So what made you, what was your major catalyst for going into cannabis? I know that it's not really, I mean, it's not like the barriers to entry are low. It's something that you have to do a lot of research. You have to kind of, you know, get involved in certain ways in order to know what you're doing and do it legally, yes. and safely. So what was your inspiration to get into that?
Funny story. I would say that my catalyst started with one event. I synchronously found an event planner who was gifted with this great party. It was called Gypsy Jane. And so it was a huge music festival that they had hosted here. It was gonna be cannabis friendly. And I had wanted to reach out to the event organizers to become a volunteer. Thankfully, I had met someone who already had the access to the event. Mm-hmm. So I got on the team. I was planning everything from logistics for all 12 artists that came into town to their hotel gift bags, and started getting sponsors to actually come to the event and book booths. And that's kind of where I saw that not only is cannabis my passion in my life, because uh-huh. I can be who I am, I don't have to hide, I don't have to, like in the hotel business, hide who you are by yeah. not really expressing those deep truths about yourself, and just kind of putting on your work mode. I was able to see that. And secondly, I was able to see that my passion was with events, that I loved the chaos. I loved how crazy it was, and getting a schedule 2 days before, having 2 hour notice for flight changes, and having yeah. to be able to work with that is how I realized that this was something I wanted to do, and I don't want to work for someone. I'd rather do it for myself and make it great.
Love it.
Thank you.
So as a woman who's been in the event planning business at some point, I had a lot of experience doing, you know, major events, $30,000, $50,000, and it is a headache. It is crazy. It's already overwhelming.
Yes.
And I'm sure adding in that cannabis aspect was added in another interesting piece that you have to coordinate with. What kind of goes into having to coordinate all of these things? I mean, what do people bring it with them on their own, or do you supply it? Is there something that goes in there as far as legally what you have to do in preparation for it? I mean, how do you handle all of that?
Well, it's quite easy. When I tell people actually that I'm working in marijuana events or that I throw marijuana parties, everyone's astounded, like, what is that? What is a marijuana party?
Yeah.
And really, it's just a normal party. It's a regular event where people can smoke at the event. They do bring their own. So legally right now, we're not allowed to supply it. Dispensaries okay. aren't allowed to sponsor it because it's not been sold at their establishment. So people do bring their own, but we provide the apparatuses for them to smoke out of. So we'll have bongs set up and dab rigs and all sorts of things, pipes. We do a lot of giveaways too. And so we'll give away all these items just to kind of tie people into the industry. The main thing that sets us apart from other events is that there's a different level of comfort.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody's there with a very comfortable demeanor, and it's very friendly. I mean, everyone's smiling, happy the entire time. And when you go to an alcohol-focused event, you have a lot of different feelings, mixed feelings, jealous men or women. You know, you don't know. There's always variables that happen when you have alcohol involved. But when there's marijuana, it's always very friendly. It's
really?
A really nice environment. And I always encourage people who don't smoke to even attend our events because you'll still meet really great people. There's a lot of good conversations that happen. So that's one of the big things that I always pride myself on is that people are coming out and they're having really, really great conversations because you're already on a higher level of thinking, per se.
Yeah. Okay. Well, clearly I have never tried cannabis before, so I don't know a lot about the mellow, you know, you talked about people having a different air. I mean, what is it about cannabis that makes that atmosphere? I mean, it's a weird question, but I feel like there's got to be somebody else that's wondering this.
No, there's a lot of people. What makes, okay, so you have to repeat the question.
What makes cannabis so different from alcohol?
Okay, a lot of things. So first, there's no aggression. So you really don't have that level of aggression that if you get bumped or elbowed, it's really like, oh, I'm so sorry.
Oh.
How are you? What's your name? You know, and you have that friendly atmosphere. So the mellowness just comes from the cannabis. It really gets into your bloodstream. It does evidently calm you and calm your demeanor.
Okay.
It kind of slows down your cycle. So alcohol is considered a depressant. And so when you're going into a state of a depressant, you're already going to be very susceptible to other people's comments or criticism hurting you. I think marijuana users don't take things personally, and so that kind of makes it really comfortable.
Wow.
And I know, like, when I've worked prior to in other events, I'm much more carefree about things. Like, someone says something, and I'm like, whatever. Okay, that's fine.
So do you think we'll transition someday and start moving towards more of a mellow cannabis society versus alcohol, or do you think, you know, we're gonna, you think the trend is still gonna stick with alcohol for a long time?
I think alcohol is a very big industry, and it has, personally, I don't think it has any benefits, but it does have a lot of appeal to most society, and so the whole idea of alcohol versus cannabis is gonna be down to, well, how can we get social clubs for cannabis? That's the main thing right now that we're pushing for in Denver, is to be able to have social clubs where you're not mixing alcohol and cannabis. They did try to get a petition together to have cannabis clubs allow, or cannabis allowed at bars.
Okay.
But then a lot of the bar association turned that down. And it's a good thinking because you're mixing alcohol and cannabis, and not that it really affects people in any different way, but there are those aspects that then you can blame cannabis users for being alcohol tendencies, you know?
Yeah, I gotcha.
So we're working on getting social clubs where you can just come in and smoke cannabis, kind of like if you think of Amsterdam with the coffee shops and the cafes.
Mm-hmm.
We want to be going towards that.
Yeah.
So I do see that there is a transition, and I do think that cannabis can be a lot bigger than alcohol because you can do it at home. You can do it any time of the day. There's no overdose. There's no toxicity to your body. The only toxicity that you're really taking in is that you're smoking.
Yeah.
And so obviously if you're smoking anything, that's not good for your lungs and it can
right.
be harmful. But as far as what the side effects are, I mean, it just brings you into states of enlightenment. It helps you evolve mentally or emotionally, whatever you want to say. So I don't know about the differences between them, which one's going to be bigger in 3 years.
Yeah.
Or if they're going to be equal, I'm not really sure. I think there's always going to be people who want cannabis.
Yeah, okay. So I can see already the benefits of having something like this. If you have this kind of atmosphere attached to your brand, how that could make people feel more comfortable and trusting and have a great experience attached to your brand. Is that really kind of the motto of your business?
Yes, it is. So right now, an all-time high, I'm hosting once a month. It was a twice a month party, but we're going down to once a month. I call it Lifetime Buds.
Mm-hmm.
So buds, obviously a play on the word for bud of marijuana.
Yeah.
And the Lifetime Buds events are really meant to bring people together in a social environment. So it's kind of just like a social networking party. It started with focusing on business owners and being able to connect business owners with other business owners so that they could help each other in business-to-business affiliations. Mm-hmm. Now it's opening up more to the market and the employees in the market, so bud tenders, people that work in dispensaries, anybody really that works in any kind of affiliate company. And so I'm really excited as far as being able to grow that and grow that name and build the brand with the name of Lifetime Buds or All Time High. Obviously, automatically people know All Time High. They're like, oh, what do you do, marijuana? And so, I mean, that's what I wanted. I wanted that to be the stimulus with the name.
Yeah. So do you have any sort of mentors or anybody that's been an inspiration to you in this business?
There's been a lot of people who are doing big things in the industry that I like to follow their persona, really, of what they're putting out. I don't personally have any mentors. I haven't reached out to someone like, hey, can you be my mentor? Can you please help me? I'd really like to learn more. Uh-huh. And I'm not sure if it's a pride thing or if it's just that everyone's really busy. Yeah. So everything right now in the industry is so busy that it's really hard to connect one-to-one with anyone, especially the ones that are the big movers and shakers right now, because everything changes in a moment in the industry right now. Regulations are coming up. Every week there's something new. So there's either an amendment or there's just a new event. Like, everyone's just running around like chickens with their head cut off, trying to show up at every event and be everywhere and get their name out there. So it's really hard right now for me to find a mentor. I've just kind of been going off my own experience and my own desires of what I want to bring to people.
Okay. So how did you learn about all of this? When it comes down to studying, you mentioned the legalities. How do you keep up with that? Do you have a lawyer that teaches you everything, or do you study it yourself?
I do have a lawyer. I also follow a lot of blogs and forums, and that's kind of how I am able to follow all of that. On my social media and Instagram, I share a lot of different posts of new initiatives that are coming up, or petitions, or events where businesses are going to be talking about those new things. So right now it's really a lot of just showing up to events and just being there to hear what people have to say. You get a lot of repetition, but there's still always something that you can learn from every event.
Yeah, that's good business for anybody if you're, you know, ever trying to start an entrepreneurial venture. You know, just keeping in touch with people that are doing what you want to do. And I know you do have that business background from your degree program and some of your history.
Yes.
Yeah, so it's great that you incorporate all of that into your life,
right now. I studied business and hospitality, and so I'm really doing a lot of that conjunction right now.
Okay, good. Well, is there anything that you'd love to share with all of the viewers that are watching right now about cannabis, about your industry, about your business? What would you like to tell them before we sign off?
I'd like to tell anyone that's not in Colorado that wants to legalize in their state that you can do it. You just have to get a good group of people together, go to your city council, and just start a petition and get it moving. So that's pretty much how we got it here. That's how any other state got it. Really is that having the desire and showing that you want something, the city will listen, and then you'll be able to kind of snowball from there. And so I definitely want national legalization. I think it would be very beneficial to everybody medically and recreationally to be able to engage in cannabis. We've had a lot of people coming here to Colorado to be able to try cannabis, children, and that are healing, having extreme comebacks. I remember one story of a child with autism. I think he was 13 years old and never spoke until he was 13 and moved to Colorado and started using cannabis. Really? In his third month, he was able to speak. And so it's stories like that that I follow. I hear a lot about on social media, and I'm always sharing it because it's really, really influential.
Yeah, I've heard about using it for, I've seen people put it into paste for
skin
ailments.
You can use it for anything, epilepsy. Like, they're even saying now for PTSD that there's certain strains that you can use for it, all types of cancer and a lot of other ailments. And then my other plug would be to come out to one of my events. And so you can just go to my website, I believe will be posted on the interview.
Yes.
And on there I have all my events listed. If you are not able to access an event, just email me. I'm really, really good about emailing back. All of my events are private, so you have to have a password to be able to access anything. And just come out, just check it out, even if you're not a marijuana user. If you're interested in what we do or interested in bringing your business, financial advisor, lawyer, whatever it is, if you want to work with cannabis businesses, it's the right place to come out because we bring a lot of business owners.
All right. Well, thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you.
You've shared so much.
Thanks.
This
is
awesome.
A nice short time.
Yeah.
Imagine if we had an hour interview.
I know, right? All right. Well, thank you so much for watching Inside the Women of Denver with me, Crystal Covington, and Arielle Labov. I want you to always remember that you deserve to be seen, heard, and known. I'll see you again soon.